This is my all-time favorite and a legendary one, a build that I've played multiple times and farmed several divines, including 3 mirrors from Expedition. You can cruise through the early maps until you can upgrade the build to the version that I've specified here. It's very easy to level and scale the damage. Even the playstyle is one of the safest archetypes, making it much easier for casual players to enjoy the endgame. The version that I have here is not the same as everyone else's. There's a massive difference in my leveling, gearing, mana reservation, and gem setup compared to anyone else's out there. So feel free to compare it yourself to decide which one is suitable for you. So it's a build that can be utilized for both clearing and bossing. In practice, it applies the strongest ignite based on the number of arrows or fuses in the target. This requires you to have a high attack speed, a moderate skill effect duration, while also scaling the total number of ballistas that can be spawned. So it's a build that can be utilized for both clearing and bossing. In practice, it applies the strongest ignite based on the number of arrows or fuses in the target. This requires you to have a high attack speed, a moderate skill effect duration, while also scaling the total number of ballistas that can be spawned. I'm going to explain everything that you need to get this legendary build started, so that you don't have to search anywhere else for this. And for the purpose of this video, I'll even show you how to craft the endgame bow, quiver, and the amulet for this build. So even if you're not playing this build, you can make a ton of currency crafting the items for this build, as there's a large portion of the player base who will be playing this build on a league start. It is very important to note that since we're taking the Elemental Equilibrium Keystone, which is a 25% exposure instead of the regular 12%, we cannot have any external modifiers to flat fire damage in our build setup. If you're having any doubts regarding this, you can check the tooltip for modifiers to flat damage output. You can also check out the value of fire damage from the gem, along with external sources of cold or lightning damage to trigger this buff. Unlike most of the other attack skills, this one scales with gem levels instead. Another aspect to avoid is any modifiers to pierce chain or fork. Ideally, you want all your arrows to stick in the target. If your arrows go through the target, then you'll not be able to deal the damage from the skill gem. Another aspect you don't get from the notes near the witch class is accuracy. This build requires at least 90% chance to hit to have a consistent damage output. You can get a decent amount of accuracy from the gloves, helmet, or even your rings. If you don't find any, then you can use a precision aura at the early stages. Scale as much attack speed as you can, but maintain a total of 45% increased skill effect duration in your passive tree. Too much can be a delay and a loss of DPS, and too low of a value will make it more difficult to maintain the maximum stack of fuses on the target. These are the main things you need to look at when setting up this build. Also, for your information, the actual DPS of the build or any ignite build is the total dot DPS value in the POB. The combined damage is not a reliable value and can be manipulated in several ways. All uniques presented in the POB are optional. Stormcloud and Skirmish are the best for a budget version, but I do not recommend using Quillrain at all, and I'll demonstrate the crafting guide for the endgame item soon. The nearby enemies have increased resistance from Eye of Malice, can only work at close range. When it does work, all the negative resistance from the target will be further decreased. And with Elemental Equilibrium, you don't need any sources of exposure from your gear setup. Defensively, you can also use a rare helmet with life, resistances, chance to suppress spell damage, and a crafted fist taken as elemental damage. You'll have to unlock this from Corel in the Syndicate. Cloak of Flame is another optional unique. You can also use a rare chest piece with some life, chance to suppress spell damage, and fist taken as elemental damage. You'll have to unlock this from Gravicious in the Syndicate. For the boots, look for the following modifiers. The best upgrade for boots is Legacy of Fury, which will take a couple of days to be cheaply available. If you're proccing Elemental Equilibrium with lightning damage instead of cold, you can make use of Pyre in this build as well. This is another damage multiplier and is great for those who want to go all into a glass cannon mode. But make sure you don't have any flat fire and cold damage if you're using Pyre. Polaric Devastation is a devastating damage multiplier for this build. This is more than a million of total damage difference. However, this is also a Pinnacle boss specific unique, which is not cheaply available at league start. Dydian Dawn is the only best unique belt for this build. Since it's a tier 2 unique, this should be cheaply available in a few days of league start. Aim for this and try to get the Turbulent Catalyst to raise its damage numbers furthermore. If you're using too many uniques from the options that I've provided, this will cause issues with attributes and resistances. So you can either go with the POB that I have in this setup or improvise carefully to distribute the requirements anywhere else in the build, such as the rare jewels. You can even use Grand Spectrum jewels to make things better. You'll need a life flask with immunity to bleeding and corrupted blood. These utility flasks are optional as your flask sustain is completely dependent on killing the monsters. You can even use 4 life flasks when you fight pinnacle bosses. For gem setup, we have to generate frenzy charges manually with frenzy, as you cannot use mana forged arrows in this build. You can choose to use determination instead of haste if defense is your priority. The flame surge flame ability with Arcanist Brand is a massive debuffing ability here, and burning damage support helps the flame surge. Getting the socket colors is indeed a difficult thing for this build on a 6 link. I would recommend using the crafting bench to get 3 of the colors. It's actually more easier to get the colors with tainted chromatic orbs, but this requires the item to be corrupted. If you're lucky to get 4 red sockets, Empower is much better than Deadly Elements. The old Vorhichi will truly be missed for this. So if you don't have Polaric Devastation Ring yet, you can use Infernal Cry, Link to Call to Arms to get the covered with Ash effect. Usually people would use Life Tap on every skill for this build, but in my version, Mana Regen is much better than Life Tap, as it opens up a much more space in a time where sockets are valuable. And this is why we are using this amulet with such a high mana regeneration rate. It scales with the Clarity Aura that we're running. If you run into issues early, you can still use an Enduring Mana Flask. For mana reservation, Sovereignty and the Mana Mastery is more than enough to sustain the auras used in the build. If you run into issues early before getting the Mana Mastery, you can either remove haste or maintain a low level clarity in your aura setup, and you'll have to swap one of your major auras to fit this. The leveling section of the guide is extremely important for all players, including the veteran ones. This build is very dynamic and squishy. Every notable and keystone that I've taken in this build is valuable and has a purpose. If I had the space, I could have gone for Spiritual Command, which is easier to scale the attack speed because minion mods are higher than player mods. But on a league start scenario, we'll need a lot of basic stuff before this, as this is why I have a separate POB for the endgame version.
Act 1, Scene 1.
From Act 1 to 4, we are a caster build with this setup. Now, here is an important part. When you switch to Explosive Arrow after grabbing Shaper of Flames, there's going to be a lot of changes in your passive tree, gear, and gem setup. Under no circumstances take Primal Bond until you switch to EA and test your build. If you don't get any accuracy in your gear, make sure to use Precision Aura. This will require you to sacrifice one of the major auras. At the early stages, Ballista Totem support is weak, so I recommend you to level the gem from Act 1 in your offhand. Primal Manifestation will greatly benefit the Ballista Totems from the stage. The notes at the top left is the priority over going south. As soon as you take Sovereignty, you can grab 2 major auras along with Clarity. You might have to cap the level of Clarity gem to a lower stage, or until you get the Mana Reservation Mastery. You can use an Enduring Mana Flask instead. You can fix attributes with these notes and the amulet. By the time you reach maps, you can grab resistances here along with a rare jewel to fix whatever that you need. Once you grab the Elemental Equilibrium, make sure to keep checking your tooltip if there's any flat fire damage in your gear. There are 2 ways to craft the bow. One is with fossils using corroded, metallic, and jagged to get +1 and +2 to prefixes. This can be expensive and requires item level to be above 50. The other method is with shrieking essences of dread. Once you get a prefix with elemental damage with attacks and an open prefix, use the crafting bench to add cannot roll attack modifiers. I have made a mistake in the video wasting 2 divines to clear all the mods at this point. Ideally, you need at least 1 open prefix and 1 open suffix at the stage. Once you add cannot roll attacks, using Exalted Orb in the prefix is guaranteed to hit a +1. With the prefixes ready, you can clear the suffixes with prefixes cannot be changed and scour. This is the easiest way to craft your main hand weapon. Crafting the quiver can vary in price depending on the mods you want and the luck you get while crafting. For double dot multi, you cannot use a fractured base since you have to use an influenced orb. To begin with, a broadhead or primal quiver is an ideal base to craft. Roll alterations until you get a tier 3 or tier 1 dot multi with attacks, and augment a prefix into it. I was quite lucky at this craft, but I'll show you how it usually goes. Now regal it to make it rare, and then block all attack modifiers to get the increased damage with bow skills. At this point, you can call it a day and benchcraft a prefix. If you want to go big with double dot multi, you'll need a hunter influenced orb to be applied for the final suffix. Most likely you'll get something related to poison or chaos. But this is the worst modifier you can get at this stage, because once you have applied the influence, there's no going back. In case you didn't get tier 1 or tier 2 life, you can freely use Orb of Annulment while you have cannot roll attack modifiers, as this prevents the damage over time modifier from getting removed. If you get chaos.multi with Hunter Exalt, you can still sell the item for a very good price on trade. To get +2 on your amulet, it would take quite a lot of patience with thousands of alterations until you get +1 to the level of all skill gems. Alternatively, it's better to buy a base that already has this mod in it. It is important that the item level has to be at least 76. It has to be made into one prefix with the +1 level of all gems along with one suffix. You might have to use beast crafting to shift a prefix to suffix. With a total of one prefix and one suffix, benchcraft the following modifiers, then use harvest augment with the removal to get +1 to fire skill gems. Once you get a total of +2, you can add any modifier of your desired choice into it. If you find this one difficult, just get an amulet with +1 and damage over time multiplier. If you enjoyed this guide, make sure to check out my other builds from the 3.24 series. And thank you for watching.